I'm associate professor in media studies at the University of Nottingham. Today I'm going to talk about Chinese queer cinema. My purpose for today's talk is to give you a very brief history of the queer representations on Chinese screen. So in other words, we're going to watch some film clips and think about how queer characters are represented on screen. What made those screen representations happen, and what's the politics of such representation? So here we go. So before we start, let's look at some terms. So we have lots of terms to describe gender and sexual minorities, including LGBTQ, queer, 同志, 同性恋, and so on. So they are different linguistic terms, but I argue that they also shape gender and sexual subjectivity in specific ways. So we therefore need to look at the different gender and sexual subjects constructed on the screen and in what discourses they are situated in. So let's start actually by looking at a highlight of Chinese queer cinema. So many of you probably know or don't know that in 2019, a Chinese queer cinema won the famous Teddy Award 2019 during the Berlin Film Festival or Berlinale.
Good evening. I am here to introduce a wonderful group of people. Every year, 7 individuals come to Berlin, and we have the pleasure to welcome them, and they form the Teddy Jury. They sit together for a week, they watch a huge amount of films, this year 20 plus, and features and a lot of short films. They discuss, they engage, they get to know each other. They arrive here as strangers, but they leave as friends, and that's always one of the most beautiful things that we get to see each year. They're here, and I think we have a clip to introduce them all afterwards.
Okay, so we'll skip the clip, but go to our central character, Purple Fan from Beijing Queer Film Festival.
Representatives come on stage to give away the Teddy Award, the jury prize. Please welcome Purple Fan and Jay Bernard.
So I apologize for the low volume.
Such a pleasure to have you here, researchers, your colleagues. Maybe we have a little talk before we give away the award. Well, you live in Berlin now, you're also a filmmaker, not just a programmer, but you've worked for a long time for the Beijing Festival, which I think has been going on since the early 2000s. And I remember in 2012 we had a colleague of you, Yang Yang, here on the jury, and we also showed a documentary on the guerrilla tactics that the festival had to develop to be able to take place each year and to find safe spaces to project the films. Maybe you can talk a little bit about the activism that you put down there.
So they were talking about Beijing Film Festival, and Yang Yang, one of the festival organizers, made a documentary called Our Story.
And I really hope there will be more international support
Okay, so that's Pu Pu Fan introducing the Beijing Queer Film Festival. So let's see the kind of big revelation when Pu Pu Fan opens the envelope for the Teddy Award 2019.
Created under intensive political scrutiny, yet with the creative nous to avoid censorship. The winner of the Special Jury Prize 2019, I'm so proud of you guys. It is a dog barking at the mall.
So that's a Chinese queer film called A Dog Barking at the Moon, directed by Xiang Zi. Okay, so we're going to talk more about this film. We're almost at the end of today's lecture, but let's go back to the earlier history of queer films in mainland China. So my talk today is divided into three parts. So in part one, I'm going to introduce a kind of earlier queer representations, which I call celluloid comrades. So drawing on the term from Lin Songhui or Songhui Lin's book of the same title, which basically talks about those kind of implicit representation of queer characters in Chinese cinema, or the kind of hidden representations you have to read between the lines. Okay, so I argue that queer films do not simply represent LGBTQ characters and desires, they also actively construct these identities and desires. Moreover, the making and screening of these films constitute part of China's ongoing queer activism. So queer films play a very important role in China's queer activism. Okay, so it's difficult to really to find which one was or is China's first queer films, because a lot of films could have been read in a kind of subtle and implicit way. For example, Yao Chai Postman is such a story, and some people even read Da Yue Bing, The Big Parade by Chen Kaige as a queer film, or a film that portrays homoerotic sentiments in the army. But what's for sure is that Chen Kaige's 1993 film Farewell My Concubine famously embed a queer character, a queer protagonist, and a queer actor, Leslie Cheung. Leslie Cheung into this film. So this film is called Farewell My Concubine. So a lot of people may have seen the film, but it's worth watching the trailer to appreciate the full beauty of this film. And this film is based on a historical drama, showcases the kind of the history of Peking opera performance over half a century.
他们有他们爹的阿纳奇没有他们爹的弟子老公啊你们算是干了吗小云姑年方二八正青春被师父削去了头发我本是女娇罗又不是男儿郎
台上的太太小姐上，给弟弟流氓上，宪兵警察上，咔，给大西方元始清，咔，
现在成角了，不大了。你们杀了我吧！
他是个戏痴、戏民、
戏疯子。
Okay, so that's a film trailer for Farewell, My Concubine by Chen Kaige. Okay, so what's interesting about this film is that it really portrays a kind of queer love, although the film never say except explicitly that these people are gay or this is queer love. However, you can feel the kind of sentiment or emotional attachment between those people.And also, it is known that Chinese opera has a very strong tradition, a long history of homoeroticism. So in a way, tracing the history of Chinese opera and cross-dressing performance, Danjue, act as a form to reclaim and recover hidden and forgotten queer history.But this film has also been criticized by many people for kind of creating a kind of orientalist spectacle and national allegory for Westerners at international film festivals. So in fact, whether Chinese opera was really like this or whatever is hardly known. But what's undeniable is that this mainstream filmAlthough it has been cut for many times, still presents this ambiguous queer sentiment on the screen. You just need a queer sentimentality to read between the lines, to read behind the screen. So this is what we call queer subtext, that is queer text that is hidden, that is not so obvious, that relies on people'squeer reading, so to speak. Okay, so if Farewell, My Concubine is a form of queer subtext, it's kind of implicit representation, then there was a form of explicit representation in which the gay character in the film basically came out to the public saying, I'm a homosexual, I love you, and why don't you love me. So basically, those were bold statements. And those bold statements were articulated at a particular circumstance when a cruising gay man was arrested by the police, and then police took him into the police station for an overnight interrogation. And then during this overnight interrogation, the gay man talked about his desire, his wishes, and his love for the policeman.And I won't give out more stories, but this is a famous queer text, which is called East Palace, West Palace, directed by sixth generation filmmaker Zhang Yuan, based on Wang Xiaobo's theater script, as well as novel, Si Shui Rou Qing, Tender Like Water. So let's watch a clip or watch the beginning section of this film.East Palace, West Palace. So by the way, East Palace, West Palace refers to two public toilets near the Forbidden City, so where gay people often cruise. They show the kind of a raid, police raid of homosexuals in the park when they were cruising.
Hey, 小子，你别走，站着别动啊！
真是没我什么事儿。
站，这我抽你啊！哎，站着别动啊！哎。 司令，好好站着。你
做什么呀？
啊，不男不女的，就是你整天没事跑这儿搞什么流氓活动啊？
看你们这几个德行，
跳，就这小子，
怎么
着？老还不自在？
欠揍了！
对，列队。蹲下，站起来，嘿，跑！我看你往哪儿跑，跑！那你
OK? I'll stop here. So basically, this.Well, in a way, showcases the harsh living conditions of the cruising gay men in Beijing at that time in the 1980s and 90s. So Zhang Yuan, together with Wang Xiaobo and Li Yinghe, conducted some sociological research into the lives of homosexuals. And Li Yinghe and Wang Xiaobo later wrote 他们的世界, so their world, which was a kind of sociological research into homosexuality.So this film is the first explicit gay-themed films in post-Mao China. It basically signifies a kind of coming out of Chinese homosexuals or Chinese gay people on Chinese screen, and it's very bold and explicit representation of queer people. So the next film that we're going to watch is今年夏天 or this summer.So many of you may know that there was no lack of gay male representations on Chinese screen. But you might be wondering, so are there any female representations or lesbian representations? Yes, there was. So the first lesbian documentary or non-lesbian documentary was He Zi, The Box by Ying Weiwei. And then the first lesbian feature was directed by female and feminist filmmaker Li Yu in 2001. And this film is called Fish and Elephant.今年夏天 So this film was the first lesbian feature in the PRC. So it was made in 2001. And in 2001, it was an important historical juncture when homosexuality was removed from the mental classification of the mental disorder classification. It was also a time of Beijing Queer Film Festival, the first edition. But now, let's watch a trailer from Fish and Elephant, 今年夏天, directed by filmmaker Li Yu. And Xu Tou, the famous lesbian actor, painter, and artist, and filmmaker, was playing the leading role in this film.
这是我自己设计自己缝的，
是你做的？
这工艺挺好的，现在会做衣服女孩很少呢。怎么样？我穿怎么样？
嗯，挺好的，
还不错哈。
嗯，
想的是为你设计。哇！
So one of them is a zookeeper, so that's why that there is elephant.
看到没有那个大象牙呀？第二天的母犬都没有那种牙齿。啊，原来也是你的。
是啊。
谢谢你照顾了我，我说今天来请，请你们看看。
你说什么？
我想今后请你吃饭。
问什么呢？六五六七六九六九，
别不小心洗掉了。
不行，委屈你一下。
生怕我
那你还爱我吗？
Okay, so this is a film trailer from Li Yu's 2001 film, 今年夏天, Fish and Elephant. Okay, so the next film that we're going to talk about is probably a lot of people have heard of it, Lan Yu. So Lan Yu was adapted from an online queer fiction or comrade literature, 同志文学, called Beijing 故事, Beijing Story. So this film portrays a kind of 10-year love story and entanglement between two men. So basically those two men met in Beijing, one is a rich business person and the other person is a kind of university student who had to prostitute himself for money to earn tuition fees. And at first they thought it was just a kind of play, but eventually, they discovered that this relationship, this emotion, is more than a play. Then things become more complicated. So let's watch a film trailer from Stanley Kwan's 2001 film, Lan Yu. And of course, this film was made by a Hong Kong queer filmmaker. So therefore, it has different emphasis from that in the novel.Okay, sure. So that was the film Lan Yu from a kind of Stanley Kwan film from 2001. Okay, so after talking about the first part, which is earlier queer feature films up to 2001, what happened after 2001? So, of course, 2001 was important because homosexuality was removed from the mental classification, mental disorder. And a few years ago, in 1997, homosexuality was removed from China's criminal law, therefore was no longer seen as an offense, as part of the, what, 流氓罪, so hooliganism. So, at this point, so queer communities started to grow, and a lot of queer people started to pick up their cameras to make queer films. And there was also an important change or historical shift, which is the kind of, what,widespread of the digital video cameras or the kind of popularity of digital video cameras when people started to use digital cameras and make their own stories. This signaled a historical change in representation because we see more and more queer representations by queer people themselves. So they see it as a type ofactivism, which I call digital video activism. So digital video activism was symbolized by many things. So one of them is the Beijing Queer Film Festival started in 2001, so at Peking University campus. The first edition was pretty much smooth, and on the second edition, then, well, before the film festival starts, and the venue provider at Peking University discovered it was a queer film festival, then it shut down the queer film festival, and then the festival organizers had to find a new venue on the spot. So, and despite the difficulties, Queer Film Festival lingers on and on, and now is still going on, rebranded as the Beijing Love Queer Cinema Week, Beijing Ai Ku Dianying Zhou. So in a way, Beijing Queer Film Festival is a kind of community event, but it is also a form of queer activism using digital videos and screens. So when talking about queer identified filmmakers, there are many. So one of the leading figures of them is Cui Zi'en. Cui Zi'en, as at that time a professor at Beijing Film Academy and a writer who has written many queer novels and a queer filmmaker who made many queer experimental films. And many of his films actually were very queer in that they blur the gender and sexual binaries. They challenge the binary thinking in terms of gender, sexuality, and identity. And they celebrate gender and sexual fluidity. This is represented by one of Cui Zi'en's earlier films called Enter the Clown, Chou Jue Deng Chang. So that's a film clip from Enter the Clown. So his boyfriend transformed into a woman, and then Xiaobo, the character, find it difficult. He's a gay character, but the boyfriend became a woman, a transgender person. Okay, so that was a clip from Enter the Clowns, Chou Jue Deng Chang by Cui Zi'en. And many of Cui Zi'en's films, as I mentioned, actually are very experimental. They use experimental aesthetics, so very much influenced by cinema verite and Italian neorealism. But they also have their fantasy element in it. And Cui Zi'en is one of the most famous and established queer auteurs from China today. And most of Cui Zi'en's earlier films were feature films, like Enter the Clowns. But after 2001, Cui Zi'en started to participate in queer activism and became an organizer of the Queer Film Festival. So he started actually to think about China's queer history and the history of China's queer communities and activism. So a film was born, and this film is a classic in Chinese queer history. This film is called Queer China, Comrade China, Zhi Tong Zhi, so which is a history of queer activism in contemporary China from the 1990s to present. So I was very lucky actually to be one of the translators for the film subtitle, and this is an important document, historical document for China's queer communities. So that's Xian, the director, organizer of the lesbian group, Tong Yu, Common Language. Okay, so this is the interesting film clip. I chose this film clip because it demonstrates a kind of politics of queer China, comrade China. So through this film, Cui Zi'en tried to explore many questions, including what's Chinese about Chinese queer identity and Chinese queer activism. So what are the kind of what Chinese element that is different from Western LGBTQ movement? So if East Palace, West Palace was the first film that a gay man came out to the public on screen saying I'm gay, then Queer China, Comrade China was the first collective coming out of China's LGBTQ communities. It portrays LGBTQ as a community, as a collective, as a multiplicity, as a combination of people. In other words, so there was a sense of community construction and identity formation. So that was Cui Zi'en, so one of the most established queer filmmakers from China. So the next person I'm going to talk about was Cui Zi'en's student when he was studying at Beijing Film Academy. He was studying script writing at that time. And then after experiencing queer film festivals, this person, Fan Popo, realizes that he has to devote himself to queer filmmaking. So Fan Popo subsequently made a series of queer films, including Mama Rainbow, Papa Rainbow, and Chinese Closet, which explores the relationship between parents and queer children in China, and Wu Niang, Be a Woman, which portrays the kind of cross-dressing performers or drag performers in southwestern China, and Vagina Monologues portrays the history or traces the history of the performances of vagina monologues in three different Chinese cities. So Fan Popo is one of the most prolific Chinese queer filmmakers, and a lot of his the films that he has made are documentaries, and they are community documentaries made with the community, for the community, and by the community. So they are important historical documents for China's queer communities. So one of his probably not widely known but most significant film was Xin Qian Men Da Jie, New Beijing, New Marriage, made in 2018. This film was important because it documents the whole process of a form of queer activism in Beijing in the form of a marriage. Or wedding taking wedding pictures in central Beijing. I'm also one of the subtitle translators for this film. So let's skip the kind of preparation stage and move on to when they arrived at Tianmen. Yes. So getting prepared for taking wedding photos. And then they also documented different responses from the audience. So those were two men, Zhang Yi and Hai Bei.
我感觉是个伴儿，不是个家，感觉哈，毕竟是少数。反正我们家讲那哥哥都是异雄，异雄一对儿。
我就是违反了人类的发展的那种感觉，我吧就觉得女同挺好的，男的都应该喜欢女的，女的喜欢女的也正常，男的喜欢男的就不太行。发展趋势就是这样，咱们这代人死了以后，下一代肯定就这方面多了。
《甜蜜蜜》，邓丽君的歌。
啊，什么叫同性恋？你知道吗？
听到了吗？
我当然知道了，就是咱们俩就是同性恋。如果大家伙都搞同性恋就行了。
要大了，对。
同性恋，同性恋是外国人。
对。
不是，人家是外国的，不是中国人。
对。都不怨咱们。传统，封建
国家。外国人现在跟中国女的结婚的太多了。
但是他不是同性恋吗？
我这不同性恋，以后发展就是同性恋了。
哇，那怎么发展同性恋？人正常结婚跟同性恋两码事儿。
知道吗？
你学美国，你还学什么？人家哪个先进的你？
学人不信
啊，同性恋就先进啊？
不，他的意思，
不太愿意你教了，不要生孩子了。慢慢的，
生
孩
子，这种生活方式。
你从今天开始就有这个了，哎，过你就是老发展这个，以后人就认识到这就习惯了，这一个过渡，从社会主义往共产主义过渡不断，他现在就是搞改革，知道吧？那改革以后再过渡一段时间，天天大街上男的跟男的女搂着，女的跟女的搂着，都看惯了，也就行了。现在好多男同志留长头发，那个也不是刚开始大家伙也看不惯，时间长了不也看惯了，对吧？他有一个过程。
你做什么工作？
谁呀？退休了，我是公安部门的，
是吧？
啊。
Okay, so I'll stop here. So basically, it is a very short film, about 17 minutes, showcasing people's different responses to.Same-sex marriage and attitudes towards homosexuality. It is an important historical document, but it also showcases the creativity of queer activism. So although queer prides were not possible in China, however, there are forms of queer weddings, or flying rainbow kites, and so on. They are also very creative and indigenous forms of queer activism.So there is a combination of documentary filmmaking and social activism, which I call the kind of documentary theater convergence. In other words, there's a very strong sense of performance and performativity in such social practices. So the next independent Chinese queer filmmaker that I'm going to talk about is He Xiaopei. He Xiaopei is a queer feminist filmmaker. So her films, mostly her documentaries, are characterized by a very strong feminist stance and queer stance. She celebrates kind of sexual pleasure, and she uses pleasure and sex to deconstruct notions such as identity and so on. So this is one of her earlier films called The Lucky One, 宠儿, which documents a person's life in the last few days of her life. So that person is called Zhang Xi. So He Xiaopei met Zhang Xi at a meeting, Pink Space meeting, and Zhang Xi asked her to documentThe last days of her life, and that became The Lucky One, 宠儿. So a lot of film footages and video footages were made by Zhang Xi herself. So in a way, this is kind of participatory video making.So let me forward the video a bit so that you get a sense of the texture and quality of the film. So on the left-hand side, you see He Xiaopei, and right-hand side, you see Zhang Xi. So He Xiaopei as a filmmaker herself is very present in the film. So here you can see that those videos and audios were actually made mostly by Zhang herself and sometimes by He Xiaopei. So He simply put everything together and created a coherent storyline. And this type of filmmaking is called participatory documentary. So He Xiaopei cast her attention on marginalized people's lives, such as gay men's wives, such as people and women living with HIV/AIDS. Okay, so another lesbian filmmaker is Shi Tou. So we mentioned Shi Tou just now. I mean, when we talk about the film Jin Nian Xia Tian, The Fish and Elephant. But Shi Tou herself is a painter. She also is a filmmaker. So in 2015, she, together with Zhao Jing, made a film called We Are Here. It is a documentary that documents China's lesbian activism. Just now we talked about Cui Zi'en's Queer China and Comrade China to be a documentation of China's LGBT, or primarily gay activism. And here we have a lesbian documentary starting from 1995, which is the World Women's Conference held in Beijing. And then this conference started a wave of feminist organizing as well as queer activism. So lesbian activism was traced from 1995 to present.
Beijing 1995. Okay!
Queer issues were in some ways everywhere and in some ways nowhere.
Women's rights are human rights once and for all.
Also the future.
That those paths in which we have taken will lead us to where we need to go.
We have to go way beyond the women's movement.
Recognize in the Platform for Action that lesbian rights are women's rights.
中国的代表团发言就说不同意跟女同性恋的权利。
中国女同性恋就一个。
调查显示75%的大众其实还是依然反对同性恋的中国。
所有的艺术家必须马上搬离圆明园。
让妇女掌握自己的身体，掌握自己的性和生育，这个事情可太让一些人恐惧了。
同性恋，同性恋，同性恋。
So this is a film trailer of We Are Here, 我们在这里, made by lesbian filmmaker Shi Tou. So this is a film also explores the relationship between feminism and queer activism in China. Okay, so there are other young independent filmmakers, which includes Yang Yang, who made a film about the history of Queer Film Festival. So as one of the curators, she's in a good position to make this film. And this film is called Our Story, the Beijing Queer Film Festival 10 Years On, or 10 Years of Guerrilla Warfare. And Wei Tingting, who made a film about about bisexuals called Shuang. And then what's worth mentioning is Queer Comrades has been a queer webcast, community webcast, and Queer Comrades has sponsored and made many queer documentaries. So in the past, annually, it has Queer University, which trains community members to make queer documentaries, to document queer lives. So that's Queer Comrades. So you can still find the Queer Comrades website and watch some of the films on its archive. It is a very rich community archive documenting queer lives, pretty much from 2007 to 2014-ish. And now the updating is slow, but it's still ongoing. So Queer University. As I have mentioned, Queer University encourages ordinary LGBTQ members to make queer films. So some of the films made by LGBTQ members, by Queer University students, include Brothers, which is a film about trans people's lives, Papa Wei Feng, which is a film about the father of a gay man. Comrade Yue, Xiao Yue Tongzhi, which is a kind of very poetic film about a rural gay man. And Yao Er, Magic, is a film about a trans woman. So these are all interesting stories. People bring their own experiences to documentaries, and they learn how to make documentaries through queer university workshops. So let's watch a trailer from Papa Wei Feng. Let's hope this works. Okay, so it doesn't look very good, but the website is queercomrades.com. So this is the dad of a gay man called Wei Feng Baba.
我的意外是 唯一一个儿子是同性恋。
So you can see Queer University on the right hand side of the screen. So that's a kind of community screening of the film, which is included in the film itself. Okay, so you can find this film on the Queer Comrades website. So again, it's 同志一番人, Queer Comrades. But let's go back to the narration. So just now we talked about how queer filmmakers from the communities use the making of films as a kind of queer activism. And most of these films are documentaries. They document different aspects of queer lives, including lesbian lives, gay lives, transgender people's lives, and so on. In recent years, there has been some queer fiction films, although the numbers are limited, but these are some of the titles that I would recommend. The first one is called Spring Fever, 春风沉醉的夜晚, made by the sixth generation filmmaker Lou Ye. So Lou Ye was basically, tracing this gay couple story and together with a woman. So it's kind of love triangle and entanglement between men and women. It also explores the issue of 形式婚姻 and pro forma marriage and 同妻 homo wife. So basically the question is, when most gay men in China are married heterosexually, what do those women do? So that's a film trailer from Spring Fever. 我都已经快逃过气了。And the story is set in Nanjing.
你在这儿等我吧，过来接你。还需要我出去跟拜他们吗？我觉得还是见一下吧。我想好怎么跟他说了，咱们就说咱们是大学同学。你没发现吗？我进来的时候看到你那个眼神，好像他认识我一样。
这是谁拍的？找人跟踪我你！你放过！对面画廊看到了吗？中间那窗户。请问一下，最近你们有没有画过？你们好好说，你知道发生什么事情了吗？我告诉你，交警，从今往后你就别再打扰我们生活了。在外面找个女的都可以，你凭什么找个男的？我问你，还你放过人还放过我？
走, 走! Okay, so that's Lou Ye. So you might have known Lou Ye's other films such as Suzhou He and Yuan Ming Yuan and so on. So this is certainly a very, very dramatic film And some say that this film actually will basically come voyeuristic gaze into gay people's lives, and it's very heteronormative. But still, it portrays a kind of gay relationship that is unforgettable. So the theme of gay people trapped in a heterosexual marriage will continue in queer representations because it is such a strong theme in Chinese queer lives. So the next one, which is probably less well known, and even for those people who have seen the film, probably they don't have many nice words to say about the film. This is a kind of China-French co-production called Looking for Roma or Seek McCartney, directed by Wang Chao in 2015. This film actually managed to enter the mainstream cinema with bad responses or negative responses because for queer audience, there was nothing explicitly queer at all, so mostly it just portrays a kind of ambiguous relationship between two men.
오늘 어느 집도 나와줘 아프리카 아직 각성이 뭐
성이 있어
是的每个人都有一次前生与后世一类巴克都有几倍不然给那么凶你没被谁是我的幻想有后无有后无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无无
So that's Looking for Roma, directed by Wang Chao, a film that after a lot of delay and negotiation eventually entered the mainstream cinema, but it wasn't a film that was popular among gay or heterosexual audiences. So now let's come to the kind of the moment revelation. So what's that film that won the Teddy Award at Berlinale in 2019? That film is called A Dog Barking at the Moon by Xiang Zi. And interestingly, this film also portrays a kind of, well, a gay man trapped in a marriage. So in other words, it's a film that involves homo wives, 同妻. So let's look at this family drama. And what's interesting, I love this film because this film is very stylistically interesting because it moves some Peking opera performances and theater performances to the screen and dramatized the film.
你爸呀，这就是病，不用管，要换就灌你奶奶把它生成这样。咱们好不容易聊会天，能不能别老说这些？去年不是一直说要离婚吗？后来怎么又没动静了？你知道吗？你进来的爸爸是个同性恋。你吃的这些动物啊，那上辈子可都是你的家亲眷属，居然还吃不下。My
mom is vegetarian now.
She said pardon me to be a vegetarian too.
很长一段时间啊，我都非常苦恼，直到等我老师的法，我才得以解脱。
It sounds like a cult.
人家薛淳笑道：“薛淳。”
Okay, so that's A Dog Barking at the Moon, 再见南屏晚钟. Of course, people know 再见南屏晚钟 is a very famous, whatever, Chinese opera or operatic song. And then A Dog Barking at the Moon is a reference to a kind of Western painting showing that well, basically people don't relate to each other, can't relate to each other at all. There's no room for conversation or dialogue. So it is a family drama concerning gay men married to women. And well, I won't give out too many storylines, but it kind of portrays a dilemma of queer people. So interestingly, this film is also made by a straight or heterosexual identified woman who is at the same time sympathetic to gay issues. So we have covered quite a lot of titles. Of course, there are many other titles that we haven't got time to cover, but let's draw a tentative conclusion. This is a very short summary of the history of Chinese queer cinema. So here we see queer emerging on Chinese screen as a historical subject. So basically, we see how fifth and sixth generation filmmakers constructed queer as a kind of marginalized social subject, as a type of national allegory. But at the same time, we also see gay and lesbian identified queer filmmakers representing queer communities in documentary format. And we see heterosexual filmmakers represent queer as subjects of love, family, and kinship, mostly the dilemmas of all those Chinese family and kinship system. But we also see under Cui Zi, and we also see queer as a radical sexual subject that challenges all the gender, sexual norms, etc. So Chinese queer cinema in the past, let's say in the past 20 or 30 years, have gone a long way. And it's also corresponding to the development of queer communities, identities, and activism in China. So with the proliferation of queer identities and representations, especially through online platforms such as 网络微电影, so those microfilms and so on, and also 网剧, so web dramas. So we are looking forward to see more diverse queer representations on Chinese screen in the future. So that's all for my talk. If you are interested in reading more about queer Chinese cinema, some of my articles might be useful. You might also be interested in reading my new book called Queer Media in China, although it's a book called Queer Media, but a large part of this book deals with queer cinema, in particular queer community documentaries. Thanks very much.